Father Kessler mentioned at the Rick of the Deutschland. But let me, because I'm trying to contextualize Indian literatures and conceptualize. But let's also look at the other story of the relationship between Catholicism and the idea of a university. The relationship between spiritual conflicts, spiritual seekings, and ideas and knowledge. And that's the reference to Cardinal Newman, who thought there had to be a certain cleansing. In fact, Father referred to it, but Cardinal Newman was the one who wrote the New Tractarian Movement, also called the Oxford Movement. The idea of the university is one of the most influential texts, that an intellectual tract goes with the spiritual, that you can't talk of the religious or the spiritual without cleansing, purifying, gaining greater ideas. Ideas are not sterile intellectual exercises. And deep spiritual explorations are not just a matter of blind faith, blind acceptance. In fact, the spirit of questioning. You can't go to the Gospels without reflecting on the nature of the self, the nature of the world, the nature of the universe. This was also Hopkins' struggle. In fact, the clash between the poet and the Jesuit priest, the Jesuits known for their exacting discipline. Going back to Ignatius Loyola, if you turn to poems like Windhoek, Father Casimir mentioned the recorded Deutschland, the death of five Franciscan nuns. But if you turn to the Windhoek, God's grandeur, pride of beauty, thou art indeed just Lord. That a man of such faith, writing poetry, had to deal with the two kinds of conflicts. That at one level he felt the deep religiosity, the rigors of religiosity had made him barren, created the barren. So, as one of the lines goes, birds build, should I not build my own nest? O Lord of life, send my roots rain. So the poetic impulse, the spiritual, the religious impulse coincides. And that's why for Hopkins, inscape and instress, that you capture the world around, quiet beauty, dapple drawn, falcon, from the wind over to everything being different, God's creation, God's grandeur. But then that he discovered that he had started becoming barren creatively. And if the creative power were to overtake, maybe his religious impulse would suffer. A great conflict which does not have easy resolutions. And as a Jesuit priest, as a poet, Hopkins was trying to come to terms with us. This is why another Catholic poet priest, Thomas, writes a poem, a very short poem called The Musician. The struggle of the musician, equated with the struggle of that man, that soul on the Calvary, equated with the struggle of the poet. So, creative processes, religious impulses, spiritual struggles, they are not separate. The question is, how does one struggle to integrate them? That's why when Robert Bridges, Casimir, initially told Hopkins, your poetry is, these were the words, your poetry is odd, obscure, and difficult. Sprung rhythm was what Hopkins was trying to create. So he said, my dear Robert, draw a deep breath and read me by your ears. Poetry is not just to be read, to be seen, words on the page. Read me by your ears, the music of poetry, and then we will begin to understand the meaning of words. So it's but highly appropriate that, that a great institution like St. Joseph's has initiated this lecture series. And who better than Hopkins that we think of to have this lecture series named after. I thank the institution, I thank you for the principal, and Jerrin for being so enthusiastic. May you become more enthusiastic, over enthusiastic, that it overflows. Now, why do I turn to why do I turn to Indian literatures? Now, for students of English literature, there is a certain crisis that teachers of English, students of English literature in particular, have been trying to come to terms with. And this crisis compels us as students at different levels, teachers being students at perhaps a higher level, and students in the undergraduate and postgraduate courses, that the crisis comes from the struggle to go beyond imitative categories. There was a point of time when we were students up to even the late 70s, when the study of literatures meant the study of literature to mean British literature, English literature, starting from Chaucer predominantly of the 14th century down through everybody, chronological linear. Whether it was Shakespeare or Milton or the Romantics later on or whoever, including the modernists, and the modernists ended with the Eminent, and the post-fiction ended with the modernists. Now it was to execute the program launched in 1835, the famous Minutes of Macaulay. But 77, and 77, something remarkable happened, and that was the publication of Orientalism by Edward Said, which argued that the construction of English studies in, let's use that unfortunate expression, but that's an expression that communicates something, that the third world, as we are characterized, the third word, that the nature of literary studies had to change in the third world or the post-colonial context. And that we could not read English literature as it used to be, the conventional, chronological, linear reading of literature. Because we had to, this is what I mean by contextualizing. To read Shakespeare, a text of Shakespeare, or to read a literary text in India, is to establish a dialogue, is to establish a conversation with our realities, with our experiences. So you can't go to A.C. Bradley or A.C. Knight or Wilson Knight or Delta F.R. Lewis, do or I.A. Richards, or do analytical criticism, do practical criticism, do literary criticism, and say we have done the analysis of works of art. This used to be the standard practice in Indian universities all over, including African universities. But then to realize that Shakespeare was not British, Shakespeare was not English, Shakespeare was ours, and that we needed to contextualize whoever. This became very evident when people started realizing that, let me hold on only to India, that English did not mean just ENGLISH, the language. Because for us in India, scholars, Sanskrit scholars, scholars in Sanskrit, Malayalam, Kannada, Tamil, Oriya, name the Indian languages, read English literature in comparison with, now this is the idea of comparative studies, with our ancient texts. Just to mention, Kannada, Hamlet became Rakthakshi. So many variations of Hamlet, Macbeth, that we were establishing a dialogue. It's not as if we plucked the text, the Shakespearean text, out of England, out of Cambridge or Oxford, and did the analysis that those professors did. That was derivative, that was too sterile. But how do we make Shakespeare our own? How do we contextualize, conceptualize Shakespeare to go with our realities, with our experiences? And it makes no sense at all to read literature, to read literary texts without being aware of one's experiences and one's realities. This became a crisis. It was quite all right until the 70s. To read English literature going by the standard books of literary criticism published in England or in America, people like Lionel Trilling or the Chicago New Critics. We need to read them, but we need to interrogate them today, which is what I'm trying to show. I'll make these broad philosophical statements and then turn to specific words, works in Indian languages. And I'll make sure that I have texts from almost all the Indian languages. Now this itself will take about 10 to 12 hours to do, but I will do whatever I can in about an hour's time. Let me name just a few writers in Kannada for that matter. And look at what negotiations they established with English. And when I say established negotiations, I mean creative and critical negotiations. Take one of our big names, Puttappa, Kuvempu. He was a professor of Kannada, a student of Kannada, steeped in Kannada politics, steeped in Sanskrit politics. But then, out of Indian politics, making use of the rasa or the dvani, the theories of rasa or dvani, or the Kannada grammar texts, you will not believe it. 1930s, 40s, if you go, all the volumes of Kuvempu are available. He contrasts the Indian critical tradition with the one who had just arrived as a blazing figure, I.A. Richards, Principles of Literary Criticism and Practical Criticism. Most English teachers would not dare touch I.A. Richards. But here was a man, a Kannada teacher. Now this is the kind of creative contextualization that took place in the 40s, 30s, 40s. It was B.M. Shri who brought new poetry to Kannada by translating the romantics, English Geetagar, launching a new tradition of Kannada poetry. If you read Hamlet, I would say read Shakespeare's Hamlet and immediately turn to Kuvempu's Rakthakshi. Ophelia there is Rakthakshi. It's not translation in the linguistic sense. It's translation in terms of experience, in terms of culture. And therefore it was possible, this is the crisis for English teachers. The crisis was that all Sanskritists or those working in the Indian languages knew what to do with English literature, how to make English literature our own. And our own was to avoid being secondary, to avoid going by secondary sources, to avoid being derivative. And that could be possible only if you were aware of, only if you were steeped in your own traditions. What did English also mean? This is what we must recognize now. English also did not mean British. Amazing to realize that English, the language, brought the great Greek poets, dramatists through English into Kannada. Today go to a play, a Greek character called Ajax. It was B.M. Sri who made Ajax Ashwatthaman. Ashwatthaman drawn from the Mahabharata. In the sense that Kannada or Sanskrit, Marathi, Bengali met English on the Indian terrain with Indian realities. So was it Greek or was it British or was it French? Alexander Dumas, available. Victor Hugo, available. Everything that came, Goethe, Faust, available in Kannada, transcreations. The stories, the great stories of Europe, available to people like Masti Venkateshanga, who wrote as Srinivasa. Turn to writers in Malayalam, turn to writers in Marathi, Bengali, Hindi. There were those free, open, creative negotiations. So English did not mean a chronological, linear dealing with 14th, 15th, 16th, down to the 20th century. These were the kinds of negotiations. And you would not believe, Shubram Karan knew every bit of what was written, being written, through the 50s and the 60s all over Europe, through translations. So for us, my first submission for English teachers, for students of English literature, is that we must understand, whatever be Macaulay's project, that India, the best of Indian reading and writing, the best of Indian criticism, has always been at least bilingual. Kannada English, Tamil English, Marathi English, Bengali English, Oriya English, or trilingual, Sanskrit being the third language. There was the continental notion, a continental awareness in the reading of English literature in the Indian context. This happened because we were grounded, scholars were grounded in at least two traditions. So without the UGC, the fashion of the UGC or the HRD, Human Resources Development Ministry, giving titles to departments, India was one of those great countries that established the notion of comparative studies. And bilingualism was known. Bilingualism was not a fashion. Bilingualism was an absolute unstated fact in the practice of literature. And by the way, I use a word like practice, the reading and the writing of critical articles. Why did this creative exploration, why did this free exchange face a great crisis? What was it that created the great crisis? This is where I think we need to understand that literary studies, especially literary studies in India, the literary program in India has taken a massive beating. sociology, anthropology, history, they have managed this game. But students of literature are caught because there is this massive pressure of the American academia. Continental influence was quite liberating for us. But the power, this is the whole relationship between reading literature being guided by the power of what we call, what we recognize as modern literary theory. Literary criticism opened up spaces. But the last 30 years we have entered, and postgraduate students will be introduced to theory. Theory meant, now look at the journey theory made, literary theory. 60s, French theory, French theoretical models bombarded the American academia, the American universities. And far from the British model, so we cannot end up blaming Macaulay. We know how to negotiate with Macaulay, but we still don't know how to negotiate with the power of the American academia, as we still don't know how to negotiate with the power of the American dollar in the age of globalization. Modern literary theory, through the American academia, and what is modern literary theory? In fact, almost every bit of it is French theory. From structuralism to post-structuralism, call it deconstruction or post-modernism, very fashionable, high-sounding theoretical concepts were established in the American university. And the power of the American university, this is the relationship between knowledge, power, the university, and the idea of authority. Today, teachers, in fact, if you look at doctoral thesis, it's sickening, loaded with the theoretical phrases and statements. And it's only a matter of quoting and quoting and quoting. From Derrida to Foucault to Althusser to Lacan, Julia Kristeva, just keep dropping names and no textual analysis, rigorous textual analysis. The irony of the paradox of this situation is the French discarded their theoretical models. America keeps it, and of course we are the favorite loyalists. So this is another kind of colonialism operating through theoretical models. This is the crisis. The crisis created by the American academia. The point being that we use theory. Now, in the next part, I will turn to a few Indian works to show how, because I just don't want to make it a general lecture, I also want to come up with concrete illustrations. Use theoretical models and apply them to texts. So a textual practice only means using theory as a tool, as an instrument, and then do your analysis. Actually, it's nothing but a derivative cut and paste job. It's this cut and paste job that makes us second rate, third rate scholars. And loaded with quotations from French theory, we are only tame, insipid followers of those theoretical models, and the French have already abandoned that. This is the challenge. Let me turn to a couple of texts in Kannada to say how theoretical models are resisted. Even in terms of literary analysis, stylistic analysis, when people like Kuvempu started writing, I'll try to move to other languages, and this is what I mean by contextualizing, conceptualizing literatures. When Kuvempu started writing, he had two major influences, but then he had to realize that he was working within the Kannada creative critical tradition. The third, fourth decade of the 20th century, 1930s, 1940s, meant the huge Sanskritic tradition, Western tradition, English tradition, and the Kannada tradition. So if you, even if you begin with people like Pampa or Kumaravyasa or the Vachanakaras, Kuvempu had at least 1,000 years of Kannada creative and critical tradition to deal with. He had to contextualize his writings. He had the entire European tradition before him. He had the Sanskrit tradition. Three traditions had to be managed. Pick up any work by Kuvempu today, his plays or his poetry or his monumental novels, Kanasubha Malegalthi or Malegalani Madhumagadu, you will see the integration, the blending, the convergence, the divergence of three traditions, the Kannada, the Sanskrit and the Western tradition. Turn to Bengali writers. They were struggling to do that. But those who knew only English, this is my emphatic argument. Those who knew only English, who were monolingual, continued with the colonial program. Those who were at least bilingual broke it without going to fashionable theories. Amazing that Kuvempu knew his Henry Bergson, knew his Nietzsche, knew Schopenhauer, knew the Vattaragane, the Jain texts, knew his Pampa, knew his Kumaravyasa, knew his Bhartrari. Most writers, I am giving you the example of Kuvempu, mastered three traditions. Bhimshri, three traditions. Turn to all other writers, great writers, poets, critics in the other Indian languages. They knew how to deal with it. So those who were bilingual or trilingual escaped this. But those who were monolingual, especially only English, got stuck. They didn't know how to contextualize, how to conceptualize. But our creative works started challenging these concepts. I mentioned Kuvempu. Let's move further. Social processes were going on. Post-colonial India, 1960s was the phase when there was the emergence after 1930, when you had the anti-Brahmin movement. 1960s was again the inauguration of another kind of anti-Brahmin movement, Brahminism. Under the influence of, so read all the texts in Indian languages under the influence of Gandhi or Ambedkar or Lohia. Unless we know these, the social conflicts, the political conflicts, you can pick up a work of the 60s and you will realize that it's impossible to do a literary analysis. If you are writing a doctoral thesis or as a teacher, if you walk into the classroom with an Indian text, you will realize that you cannot do what you would call literary analysis unless you are aware of, fully conversant with the major sociological, political debates in India, because these works started reflecting these. Tell to unmove the samskara, for instance, the collapse of the Agrahara, the Brahminical locality, cities are opening up. The power of the Brahmin is being challenged. The power, the authority of the Vedas, the Upanishads do not hold sway. People cannot be controlled. So it becomes absolutely necessary for the new generation Brahmin in an Indian society which is in transition, undergoing transformation, metamorphosis, to begin to ask the question, who am I? What am I? The Advaitic question of who am I, what am I is different from people like us. Asking this question, who am I? It's very different. We can't ask as those people during the Vedic or the Upanishadic ages, ask the question, who am I? The notion of the I is divided, the notion of the I is split, our context is split, our history is split, and therefore with our multiple plural realities, our millions of literary texts have to be different. So we can't borrow models, tools of criticism from elsewhere and begin to apply context as if they are cut and paste jobs. Third, let us say there are outstanding texts from the Northeast, outstanding texts by writers, at least two sets of writers, Christian writers and Muslim writers. Go through the dense details of these texts. Unless you know the Gospels, which is why Wittgenstein said, damn, 1920 Wittgenstein said, damn your Aristotle. I learn everything from Tolstoy, Dostoevsky and the Gospels. If you read texts that represent the tensions, the conflicts of Christian writers wherever they come from, and you must go through outstanding narratives from the Northeast, all published, the conflicts, the tensions cannot be resolved if you pick up those works of art, novels or short stories. You cannot do any literary analysis unless you contextualize. And what is contextualization? One is the religious, spiritual contextualization. And you can't do a religious, spiritual contextualization unless you know at least the first four parts of the New Testament, the Gospels. And unless you know the political turmoil of the Northeast, if you turn to the Northeast today. Unless you know what happened in the 60s in Mizoram, you will not understand Assam, Manipur, Nagaland, oral narratives become written narratives. Turn to the whole struggle in Kerala, in West Bengal, in Karnataka, you will not be able to. This is my main argument. To go back to my title, what is conceptualizing, contextualizing? Unless you begin to establish a relationship, a deep relationship between the literary text and the cultural context. And what do I mean by the cultural context? That you are aware of political dimensions, sociological dimensions, the economic changes, the stresses on people, on communities, on religious communities. And then you will begin to understand that India is so diverse that things, the conflicts here are irresolvable. Historical conflicts cannot be approached without a certain degree of openness. You can't arrive at solutions and believe that problems of history can be settled. Pick the great works, any work from Indian language. I pose this as a question, not as a challenge. Pick any work produced in India during the last 60-70 years, you will not be able to do any literary analysis. You will not be able to function as a first-rate creative critic unless you know the dimensions of the conflicts, the disputes, the contradictions, paradoxes, dualities of Indian reality. Because there is no single Indian reality. Turn to Sarah Joseph, the Malayali writer. Turn to the Muslim writers, the Muslim novelists or short story writers from any part of the India, of this country. Unless you know what the Quran says, especially when you turn to the Sharia, then you will need to understand, you will not understand a line of a poem or a short story or a chapter of a novel unless you begin to establish a relationship between the states of Muslims in India with what the Quran says, with the fundamentalism, with the fanaticism and the struggles of writers to deal with these, both Muslim men and women writers. So how do we read literatures? Do we just go into the classroom with our mechanical aids, mechanical tools, instruments, and practice literary criticism? There is no practice of literary criticism unless there is an attempt to evoke, unless an attempt to come face to face, confront, establish a confrontation with these mind-destroying, they are not even mind-boggling, mind-destroying tensions of our times. When was this tradition of fiction inaugurated? Premchand? But look at how we turn to somebody like Tagore. I said I would illustrate, so I'm moving from language to language, giving you examples from Kannada. Let me turn to those Muslim writers, Christian writers, now to Tagore. Read a text like Gora. And as I'm saying this, please remember, this is why theory being produced in the West after Orientalism has dropped its panels and has started restructuring its. Let me say it differently. French sociologists and anthropologists realized in the 50s that their models could not help the study of African societies and Indian societies. So for the last 60-70 years, sociologists and anthropologists and historians have changed their tools, their mechanisms. Because they have turned to societies such as ours to create new theoretical concepts. But after Orientalism, that's the major turning point, 1978, science Orientalism. We are not doing it, but the pressure is so much that American universities have started doing it, that they are turning to Indian texts and trying to create new theoretical models for themselves. So if the pressures of the so-called third world, post-colonial world can push America to redesign its critical program, what are we doing 40, 50 years behind using dead, worn-out, sterile theoretical models? Gora, home in the world. Gora is the struggle, Gora is white. The conflict, and see how it ties up with today's conflict. What is this idea of a nation? What is India as a nation? What is India as a society? Gora is a work that challenges today's notions. Tagore died in 1942, so the man died 70 years ago. But what his novels try to capture, resonate, become more and more important. There it is, the struggle of Hindu, Hindutva, Hindu Rashtra, Hindu nationalism. Tagore asked this question. I'm talking of fiction, but I'm talking of politics, sociology, religion, the ancient Indian tradition. This is how we are forced to reread our literary texts. In Gora, the realization comes that India was never and can never be a Hindu Rashtra, because India has never known this notion of Hinduism as a single monotheistic religion. India is not a land with a single philosophy. India doesn't have a single philosophical tradition. It has philosophical traditions. Hinduism is not dependent, let's use the word, is not dependent on the notion of a single book. There's no single book. Even if you are a true Hindu, you will realize that there are multiple texts. There are multiple texts, and whoever believes in one text or two texts or three texts can always recognize himself or herself as a Hindu. All problems located in a so-called fictional work, in a so-called novel. Turn to major works, Indian literary works, and I will make references to African works later on, because I want all our English literature classes to be very creative explorations with our realities, not just pass 5-6 papers of literary criticism or Greek drama and be done with it, being second-rate scholars, second-rate students. Not a single literary work the last 70 years has come out of India or Africa or Australia or New Zealand, especially written by the Maoris, or Latin America, without the literary imagination, I repeat, the last 70 years in particular, not a single literary work, and what do I mean by literary work here, poetry, drama, novels, not a single text which does not challenge Eurocentric Western notions of non-Western, non-European societies. Let me state it differently. The literary imagination today, in terms of creative criticism and creative writing, realizes that as a poet, as a novelist, as a dramatist, I cannot capture my reality without challenging, without interrogating the notions of my society, my community, my religion, myself, self-identity, created and imposed on us for decades, for centuries by the Eurocentric models. So literature today, reading literature, the act of writing literature today is a resistance to those Western, Eurocentric or American models when you move from one space to another space. All of them coalesce, Eurocentric, Western, America. Therefore, turn to writers like Achite, Yen Gogi, turn to Shoyinka. You will not find a single work, a novel or a short story or a play which is not an attempt. You will not find one which is not a conscious attempt to reshape my identity. What is that my identity? Whether it's a Kenyan or a Ugandan or a Nigerian identity, and which begins with the tribal identity. And therefore, if these are the conscious struggles of writers, creative individuals, creative works, then what should our struggle be as readers, as critics, as students, as so-called teachers? We cannot handle literature, literary texts, as if it's a tool that can be assembled, dismantled and reassembled. It cannot happen. We cannot turn to singular notions. We cannot use homogeneous categories. The study of literature, therefore, the study of literatures, the whole notion of Indian literature itself is such a basic contradiction. We can only turn to Indian literatures. And therefore, if we are to get glimpses of creative resonances, we must open up our awareness of multiple disciplines. Students of literature, teachers of literature being students of literature, need to look at allied disciplines. We cannot be good students of literature, we cannot be good readers of literature unless we become multidisciplinary. How would you read, one more illustration, how would you read Raja Rao's Kantapura? You cannot read a page of Raja Rao's Kantapura if you turn to Indian writing in English without contesting at least James Mill's history of India. It begins there. The British construction of Indian history, Hindu period, Vedic period, Muslim period, Sultanate, Delhi Sultanate, Mughal period, is a perverted construction of Indian history. So what does Raja Rao set out to do in Kantapura? Kantapura can be any place, anywhere in India, the 1930s, 1940s. Kantapura is not history. If you are doing Kantapura, please remember Rajaram in his preface makes two statements. One, he says, we should not write English as the English did. We should not, even if we can. Second, he says, we must reconstruct through creative writing our notions of history. So he says, I will write not history. If you have read the preface, if you have read the novel, you would have noticed Kantapura, Rajarao says, is an attempt, as the great African writers did, as Marquis did in 100 Years of Solitude, to create Sthala Purana. Purana is mythology. Sthala is the local. The local is rich with locals, to mean specific, the particular specificities of a particular area. The particularities which are not general, which are not pan-Indian, which are not vague and amorphous. And mythology, what does mythology mean? Mythology needs not to be equated with superstition or false beliefs, but the consciously held beliefs, systems of belief, systems of faith of people who have lived for centuries. People don't live on superstitions for centuries. It's the mythical imagination. So I'm going to capture the mythical imagination, which is not national history, but which is this Tala, the local, the particular, the specific. And I am going to capture, to challenge this overarching notion of history. How do you read, how do you analyze a fictional work like Kantapura without being aware of the constructions of the Western historians? Whether you turn to Will Durant or whether you turn to Toynbee or the later historians. So a fictional work is a fight, is a confrontation with, is an interrogation of those dominant notions of history. And unless we create new notions of history, we can't even make fiction. This is the relationship between fiction and history, fiction and sociology, fiction and politics, fiction and economics. Shall I jump to a Oriya work, Gopinath Mohanty's novel? So I'm moving across this country and moving to Africa. Read that work. And all these works I have been naming are all works that are available in each translation. Gopinath Mohanty, whose centenary was celebrated 5 or 6 years ago, wrote a massive novel called Paraja. Paraja is about the struggle of the tribes. How many of us in India today read literature being conscious of the struggles of the tribals all over? Paraja is about the extermination of the tribals, and exterminated by whom? By the British and by those Indians who conspired with the British. So it is the story of neo-colonialism. If the British masters leave us, have left us, we have the new masters. And who are the masters? The colonized people become the new colonizers. That the black man becomes the black man wearing a white mask. Without this understanding, you will not be able to read Paraja, nor will you be able to read Achipe's later work, Antlers of the Savannah. So when I walk into this classroom with undergraduate students or postgraduate students, how do I present a literary text? How do I present it today? Merchant of Venice Dream. Is it a struggle between Jews and Christians? Is it anti-Semitism? Does Christianity mean anti-Semitism? Does a Christian mean being anti-Jew? Then you can't read The Merchant of Venice without having gone through the story of the Good Samaritan. You can't read a word. It was possible for a certain point of time, up to the 70s, to read Shakespeare using Bradley or the other British critics. But today, the Good Samaritan, and I'm
I'm getting it out of the Bible. You can't read a Shakespearean text without being aware of the biblical nuances, without going through the Gospels, without going through Matthew, without going through the Sermon on the Mount, one of the great sermons of Jesus. The parable of the Good Samaritan, the story of the Good Samaritan is to say, not to say, then we'll see what it says, is not to say that a Christian must help a fellow Christian. No. It is to say that if there is a wounded Jew fallen into the pit, the good Christian in the name of Jesus shall help that Jew. Historically, anyway. But the moment you help, you become a savior to a historical enemy, you have rewritten history. And so, is Shylock the villain? Is Shylock the metaphysical evil? Is Shylock to be read as a villain created by Shakespeare's Merchant of Venice? Is this how we read? Does a Shakespearean text have a single meaning or turn to whatever? Is it that the struggle between blacks and whites? So, is Shakespeare a racist? It was possible to read Shakespeare as a racist. But today you will begin to see that there are many problems when you carry single meanings to literary texts. So whether you read Shakespeare or the Romantics or Indian writers, Kannada writers or Oriya writers or Bengali writers or Malayalam writers, Christian, Hindu, Buddhist writers, Jain writers, you will begin to realize that you cannot read a single literary text. As a teacher, as a student of literature, I cannot practice literary criticism without being aware of the great changes that had taken place and that are taking place in our context. The act of reading literature has become a major problem, and that major problem is a great opportunity for us to open up new possibilities. This is why you see two great French critics. Again, we turn to France because we are not anti-France. We are not anti-America, intellectually. Beautiful metaphor, Deleuze and Guattari. They write a book called A Thousand Platos. Look at the title. Thousand Platos, not a single Plato. In that, they come up with the image, the metaphor, the symbol, which is also a fact, of the rhizome. The rhizome, if you look at a tree, what is the tree? Only what's above the soil. How does the tree sustain itself? So if you replace the tree with a work of art, is the work of art only what we read through words, through language? Or do we look at rhizome? What are these rhizomes? Roots, shoots. And the tree is not a tree without water, without minerals coming from the soil. And it's not the leaves that suck minerals or water, it's those roots. So let us look at the diversities, the pluralities, the multiplicities of literary texts. No great literary text, no great creative work has a single meaning. What is the central, who is the central character of this play? What is the central character? These are all dead, decadent questions and decadent ways of understanding texts. No text has a single center. Does the Mahabharata have a single center? Does the Ramana have a single center? Do the Sophocles plays have single centers? Does the Odyssey or the Iliad, who is the central figure? What is the central plot? My point is, let's turn afresh. This has gone on for about 30, 40 years, 3, 4 decades. But today, we are in a position to create fresh negotiations. Students of literature, and that's why I have consciously avoided English literature. But including students of English literature, including, let's not be concessive towards the other Indian languages. Students of English literature need to be aware that they have a crisis, that they are facing a crisis. But it's also a golden opportunity for students of English literature to convert the crisis into a glorious opportunity to open up their critical parameters. to open up the frontiers of reading, to begin to see horizons, not to see boundaries, but to see horizons that always expand, that never shrink. And so far I have been talking of non-Marxist critics. Let me turn to Marxist critics who are supposed to be aware of class struggles, who are supposed to be aware of the conventional expression, grassroots realities. Let me name one Marxist critic and see how we are misread, not just in history or sociology or anthropology, but in literary criticism. I don't know if the postgraduate students do. If you don't, at least to understand the misfortunes of Marxist critics, you must read Frederick James. Frederick Jameson wrote an essay. In fact, his essay was called Third World Literatures as Nationalist Allegories. Let me explain this. Third World Literatures, so all of us are lumped together as Third World. Or you can even use that old expression, we are all backward. Backward societies. Look at the Marxist assumption. Third World cannot produce literature because Third World, I am summing up Frederick Jameson's arguments. Third World, that is people like us, all of us, as individuals, as communities, Jameson argues, we have no metaphysical being. We have no metaphysics. None of us has a soul. None of us can raise metaphysical questions. It's only the West that can raise metaphysical questions. Who are we then? Then all of us in India, in Africa, in Australia, in New Zealand, all over the world, Latin America, we can only talk about external reality. We don't have an inner world. We are dead. So you are dead within, I am dead within, you have no soul, you have no spirit, you have no mind, you have no consciousness, and that I becomes we, all of us. So pick any third world work and you can only see the nation, because we only have a public self, we don't have a private self. Replace it with other words, we don't have our interior spaces. So we don't have our metaphysics. First word has that. Jameson's argument. Which means the first world, shall we use the other correlates of the first world? The capitalist world, the white world, Western world, European world. Only there do people have a soul, they have a private life, they have an inner life. So the third world is a junkyard, is a backyard, where people assemble in public. They have no spiritual questions, they have no metaphysical questions. If this is so, then how would places like Kerala and West Bengal, especially West Bengal through its great writer, Mahashweta Devi, if Mahashweta Devi is prescribed in the classroom, how would you read Mahashweta Devi writing in Bengal? Frederick Jameson does not know a single word of any Indian language. And Marxists are supposed to be committed to grassroots workers, whether they are agrarian workers or the industrial proletariat. Look at the sweeping statements made. If I should give Mahashweta Devi in translation to Frederick Jameson, ask him to read at least two stories, Dopri or Stanadaini, the press giver. We are asked to read Marxist criticism, psychoanalytic criticism. Then what would the Western psychoanalytic critics do with Indian texts, not being aware of the Indian psyche? What would Frederick Jameson, not being aware of the complex realities of West Bengal of the 60s, the rise of the Naxalite movement, what would he make of it? This is his leading statement, you know, which is why the great Justice Krishnayyar said, while referring to a dispute in Kerala about the Mutanga forest, the Wayanad area. He said, whether it's the right front government or the left front government or the middle front government, and especially the left front government headed by the communists, Justice Krishnayar said, in India, the communists have to learn the basics of dialectical materialism. Getting the spelling of Karl Marx right first. The point is, for us, the whole point is, if we open up spaces of reading, literary texts, all of us, which means that you must read a South Indian Tamil text. I can give you the names of at least 10 significant Tamil writers, men and women, male and female writers. An English class today, and that is to conceptualize, contextualize in the literature, that we read a Shakespeare, resonance of Shakespeare in Odia literature, in Marathi literature. There is no Marathi literature, there is no Odia literature, Bengali literature, without resonances of Shakespeare. There is no Kuwempu without resonances of the Greeks, of the French, of the Germans. To read an Indian literary text, to read Indian literature today, is to come face to face with our realities, one, with the realities of the human situation in human context. Otherwise, Oedipus would not have figured in Kannada or Bengali or Hindi. The Greeks, Ajax would not have figured in Kannada. Hamlet would not have figured, Ophelia would not have figured. And therefore, to study a single literary text is to study its own historical context, and to see how a single historical context becomes a strong complex narration of the histories of other contexts. So we do not have a single notion of history, we do not have a single historical experience, but we experience histories staying where we are, rooted in the local. This is also the challenge to globalization. Globalization is not a single world with a single order, with a single historical reality. In fact, we say that the local has many global realities. So to globalize is to homogenize, but to localize is to universalize. Now it is this spirit that should guide us, that has been guiding our creative writers, and that has sustained the creative imagination of African writers and Latin American writers. If tools of literary criticism in America have changed, it's because of the complex creative pressure brought by, first, the Latin American writers, the African writers. And if they can alter models, why is it that we in India, with all the advantages that we have today, if writers in the Indian languages could do it 5 decades ago, what is it that we cannot do? If we don't do this, the English classroom will become a classroom that will produce millions of Indian Macaulays. And that would go against Cardinal Newman, the idea of the university, and that would defeat the very purpose of the Hopkins Lectures. Thank you.